Welcome to the Foot of the Cross. First of all, happy Mother's Day to everybody out there who's watching and here. And if you're here, you ain't here, you get to miss the flowers.
You got any announcements?
Gloria, I want to tell you, happy Mother's Day. But these flowers are here because I knew you won't come and I have you something different.
So you brought flowers because Gloria couldn't be here?
Because she's allergic to them.
I'm just kidding.
Mother's Day to my mother-in-law and my mom.
We spent the day with my mom yesterday, and we just want to thank everybody to subscribe. It's for the church, not us, and we're just glad everybody's here, and I'm going to shut up.
And wait, I'm going to give you a pre-warning.
Oh, no, wait a minute. Let's go here.
It was Bill's birthday. Tuesday, yeah. So we'll give Bill turned 26 again.
Birthday. But here, the name of our
subject is going to be simple as dirt. Now, I want to pre-warn you. You know how you have the little warning before every message? I'm going to talk dirty today. So get prepared.
I'm talking about it last night. I'm just kidding.
you won't put something in prayer with that one there, but I'm going to talk dirty.
You got to have fun in church. Yeah. Everybody goes into church and they still. And it's scared to raise your hand, scared to laugh.
There's no reason to be shy because we're just human.
That's right.
I know I am.
You took all the human out of me.
All right, open us
Lord,
up
we just give you praise and honor and glory for this beautiful day. Bless each and every mother here and even the ones that's watching and all of them that's not even watching. God, just bless them in a special way. Let them have an amazing day. And we just give you glory for this service and for with that we receive the word that Joel is going to give us in Jesus' name.
Wait a minute. Y'all seen that Lily said happy Mother's Day too.
I'm thank you for waking me up. With your touch, Lord, I love you so much. I'm gonna do love in all I say and do. My days begin with you. My days begin again.
I hear your worship flowing throughout the day.
And I need
love and
to show me the
way.
Shall direct
Got a front row seat to the madness. I pick up my phone every morning out of habit. I've been fiending for the drama, yeah, I said it. I'm addicted to the rush, need a medic. When I take a step back, I can see it. All the pain, all the fear we've been feeling. Losing sight of the thing that we needed. Take a good long look in the mirror. Search my heart and soul, make it clearer. Help me take your love, trade the bitter. Leave it in the dust, help me leave it in the dust, boy. We've been preaching, we've been taking in the vanity. Now it's got us questioning our sanity. And we wonder how we get all this anxiety. It's clear to me.
Charity, we are just so glad and honored to worship Jesus today with you. We wanted to share with you a brand new song. Nobody in the world has heard it. Y'all are the first ones. And it's called Back to the Garden. And, you know, we love the mix of old songs and new songs. And there's an old song that I just love. It says, "And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I'm his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known." Being in the presence of God, there's nothing like it, amen? And you know, this weekend we celebrate, on Friday we celebrated the cross of Christ. And the scripture says that as he breathed his last, the veil in the temple was torn, which gave us, those in Christ, unhindered access into the presence of God. And then this morning we celebrate the resurrection power of Jesus. And we know that he now fills us. And so not only do we walk with him and talk with him, but he lives in us and with us. Amen. That's what we're celebrating. And so we wrote this song. The chorus just says, "Lord, take me back to the garden. Lord, take me back to that place of unhindered communion, co-union with the one who loves me and made me and has pursued me from the beginning of time." And like the psalmist says, this one thing I desire, this one thing I'll seek, to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold his beauty in his temple, to just live in the light of his glory and grace. Amen. So we can't wait to share this with you. It's called Back to the Garden. Majestic and splendid, and yet holy and tender, and you're calling my name. Can I leave behind all distractions? I give you all my attention. Thank you.
What's my famous scripture? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So we've got to learn to think like him. And what I do is when I make a mistake, I try to go back to the very beginning and how I got started and what made me get interested in that. And I start searching that out. Instead of going out, reaching out in the world, I want to go back to the beginning. Just like I want to get back to the garden where he walked with me and he talked with me. And we had a one-on-one conversation and I knew he was real. See, I think the first time you get saved out of fear, out of law. And then the second time that you get saved, you get saved out of the Spirit. And you realize he's a person who loves you and cares about you and he needs us. And so my sermons will never be this great big theological doctrine teaching. It's always going to be simple. And it's as simple as dirt. And that's what God was dealing with. He says, we got to get back to the simplicity of things. And we got to understand, let's go back to the beginning of what was our purpose. He made us so we would worship him. Because the stones, he said, I could have made the rocks and the sticks cry it out. But I chose you because I wanted to have a conversation with you. And that's how special you are. And we get away from that and we start telling everybody, like the blind man, Bartimaeus. Why did they call him a blind man? Because he was blind. Don't let your handicaps identify who you are. People want to call you with your handicap. Oh, he's a crackhead. He's this, he's that. She's this and she's that. That ain't what God says. He made you for a specific reason and a cause. And we have to learn how to live with that. And guess what? And I'm off my subject a little bit, but it's not really off my subject. It says that the kingdom of heaven is like a man who found a treasure. And he went and sold everything he had and took the treasure back. And he sold everything he had and bought the land because it wasn't his. He was stealing, in other words. So he took, and guess what come back with that treasure? A lot of dirt, a lot of mess. We don't like mess dealing with the mess, but guess what? Part of the treasure comes with the mess. See, we have to understand the kingdom of God is like a man who found a treasure in a field. Now, here's the treasure was also in a field of dirt. You can't have the one without the other. We want a church. We don't want that sinner to come in here. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says all are called. So what we have to do is welcome the sinner in church. We make a sinner feel uncomfortable. And I'm not telling you to be not to sell out what the word says. Do what the word says. Do what the word says and not say what the word says. they say, well, that's the same thing. No, it ain't. There's a lot of people can quote this word as mean as the devil. Let me tell you something. The devil can quote this word. But he'll never quote it exactly the way it's said. He'll change some things and bring some deceit in it to get you to turn it on. It's called news. Turn on the news and they're deceit. This world is done for. No, no. Christ lives in me and I live in a fantastic world. I got a wife, grandkids, kids, dogs, and everything who love me. Now, do I have some trash and dirt in my life? Got a lot of it. But it's part of it. So I've learned to embrace it and learn how to use it to my good. Because if you take dirt and you put a seed in it, guess what happens? It grows, but you can't grow one with the other. You can grow it in a glass of water for a little while, but if you don't transplant it in dirt, it's going to end up just root dying. It's got to have both. We have to understand that. So I'm going to try to get on my subject. So we're going to go all the way back to Genesis, chapter 2, verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. So God took what and did what with it? Made something out of it. There's the beginning. God took dirt and made something out of it. What am I called to do? Take dirt and make something out of it. If I'm supposed to be Christ-like, I should have the same ability to take something that is dirt and turn it into something. Because the Bible says in the last days, greater works we'll do than he did. So we can't say, well, I'm not God. No, he said you would. Are you saying he's a liar if you don't? It's that simple. You can't. It's either or. It's not a shared thing. See, the number one ingredients of a miracle is dirt. We have to understand, number one miracle, we would not be here today. The miracle of you living here today started with dirt. Did I misspell something? I look around for misspelled words.
That's
exactly right. But we started with dirt, gave us the miracle of life. So we have to understand this. Now let's make it scientific. There is a new telescope invented by NASA that discovered clusters of galaxies and stars that they didn't know existed. You see, the telescope highlights where dust is. They have found that the main ingredients in the stars and galaxies formation is the life is from dust. They have discovered that all these galaxies stuff, it all generated from dust. Let me tell you when the big, do y'all believe in the Big Bang Theory? I do. Jesus said, let there be life. It was a big bang. See, everybody tries to take and say, well, science, I believe God's word and science can be put together if it's done in truth and in wisdom. See, what scientists, this telescope saying is God created. He took all the massive things and created something out of it. So we have to understand dirt and dust must be a main ingredient in God's plan. It wasn't because man failed that Jesus came to earth. We have to understand that. So we got to understand what the dirt is and respect it, but don't let it control you. See, that's where it's mind, body, and soul. We have to have a wisdom on it. Numbers 5:17, and the priest shall take holy water and an earthly vessel and of dust that is in the floor of the tabernacle, and a priest shall take and put it into the water. What does that mean? Where did I pick that scripture up? Back in the biblical days, if I was accused of doing something wrong, cheating, infidelity, lying, stealing, whatever, they would take you in front of the priest, and you was like a courtroom. And if you, here's what he would do. You would say, he would ask you as the high priest, did you do it? If you said no, then what he would do is he would take and get an old earthly vessel, and he would take and put holy water in it. And he would take and reach down to the floor and grab dust off the tabernacle floor and sprinkle it in the water. And he would shake it up. And he'd ask it one more time. This is a warning. I'm going to ask you one more time, and if you drink this, if you're lying to me, you're going to be so sick on your stomach, you ain't going to be able to stand it. But if you're telling the truth, you ain't got nothing to worry about. And he would hand it to them. And if they were lying, they would get deathly sick off of it. Now, why am I saying that? Because he didn't just do it with holy water. He had to mix the dirt that was in the tabernacle too. We can't have church because we don't let the dirt come into church. And all we do is we have services of who was the best singer, who dressed nice, like my wife. I got that one in. We have services of who did what, who didn't do nothing, and we're not winning souls to the Lord. That's what it's about. We have to understand. We have to embrace. I grew up in a church that if you burp wrong, you were going to hell, and they would escort you out of the sanctuary. We got it backwards. We should be escorting them into the sanctuary. If you was a problem child, get that baby out of here. He's interrupting my service. Your service? I thought it was God's service. See, we got it all backwards. As a man thinking in his heart, so we got to understand God loves that baby, and maybe that baby needs attention. Maybe the baby's the only one decided to shout out to the Lord. Who knows? His ways are not our ways. But we try to think of him in a layman term, get the baby out here is interrupting the word. That's not the way it is. It takes the holy water and the dirt. We have to understand that. I done said that. If we only had the Holy Church, if we had the Holy Church, we must have a revelation that what is the truth. We need both in the church. That's what I'm saying. We got to have both in the church. Ministry is only if it's been received. If I'm up here preaching, it only becomes ministry if you receive it. If I'm up here talking, I'm just a lecturist. Is that a word? If it ain't now, look up Webster. See, under Jules, there's no. I mean, somebody's just talking out loud. See, I'm a creator. I'm like my father. I create new words and new definitions. But so here's what we have to understand. If I let that stop me, and the dirtiness of my able to misspell words, pronunciate words, or to be able to talk in public, or make myself look stupid, then I would never do what he asked me to do. And therefore, would be able never to take and have y'all in the church to be able to see the friends and the family we've developed. This is the only church I've been to that on a holiday, gifts are given. I'm out of heart, not because it was on the curriculum. And here's the only church, if somebody's out, they text you and say, I'm not going to be able to make it, will you pray for me? You don't see that in these big churches. Why? Is the big churches wrong? No, they haven't got back to the simplicity of what it's all about. It's not about the building. It's not about me. It's about Jesus and your relationship with him. And my job as a minister is to get you two connected together. And sometimes the way you get you connected together, if I got Hannah and Touton there and I kept talking to both of them, that they never would have a conversation together. Who's leading the conversation? I am. So the best thing I can do is introduce them and back out and let them talk themselves. That's how Jesus handles it. That's how the Spirit does it. The Spirit don't tell you what to do. It introduces you to him and allows him to have a conversation with you. See, sometimes when I'm talking to somebody, I don't understand what they're saying. I'm trying to comprehend it. And then all of a sudden, you have that light bulb go, oh, I get it now. It might have took 20 minutes for it to go through. And then all of a sudden, I got it. I understand it now. And once I got it, it's locked in. I'm ready to go. So we have to understand that don't despise small beginnings. Don't despise the dirt in your life. Don't despise that person that's getting on your nerves. God might have him there because you're the only one that can help him. And if you don't do it, you're doing antichrist work. I know I use that word a lot, but either you're Christ-like or antichrist. It's just that simple. That's the way I had to deal with things. Am I acting Christ-like or antichrist-like? And that's not for you to answer. That's for me to answer. And it's not you to judge me. You're judged to judge yourself. Because guess what? How hard you judge me, you'll be judged. Where mercy's shown, much is given. We have to understand that God is about love. You know, we've just been doing a series about love. We have to understand what love really is. The priest would, man, I really got ahead of myself. Then let's go down to Numbers 5:21-23. The priest shall charge the woman with an oath, cursing him. Boy, I am ahead of myself, ain't I? What I just said, I just backed up in Scripture. You can go all the way through Numbers down to 22, and it tells you that they would charge him, saying, if you drink this and you're lying, you're going to be sick on your stomach. Numbers was the book of law, and that's what they would do. It was all about numbers, analytical stuff. So what happens is, why am I? Okay, slow down, Joe. Why am I talking this way? Because I'm fixing to take you to the New Testament. God says, I didn't come to do away with the law, but I have fulfilled the law. So what I'm going to take in the New Testament is not going to contradict what I did in the Old Testament, but I'm going to make it on the spiritual level. So for me to understand the spiritual level, I need to understand the Old Testament level. That's the reason you see me preach a lot in the Old Testament, because I love history sets up why they did certain things. Some things when I was reading in the New Testament, I'm going like, that's kind of gross. Why would he do it that way? Well, I mean, that don't make sense. But when I read the Old Testament and understood it, it made all the sense in the world because that's what they understood in that culture. If I am, I'm a full-fledged redneck cowboy, love country music, Harley riding, gun toting, mispronunciating preacher you ever met in your life. And I go to an intellectual person who does not like to cut up and they're strict in the thing, we're not going to talk very long because we can't find common ground. Now, whose fault is it? It's both fault. I have to learn that his culture is, he's not going to like my how y'all. And I might have to learn to talk his language till he understands, and vice versa, he's going to have to learn my language. And that's what we have to do. When we talk to God, we're going into him with our language. And God's going, I don't understand that language. Give me an example, Joel. I'm glad you asked. This is a common one. Lord, if it be your will, we pray that you would take and heal this person. Wait a minute. if it be your will. Jesus is going like, you done messed it up. You want to try that one again? Because apparently you don't understand my language. Because the Bible says, I have took a stripe for all your infirmities and your woundedness. And that and if you ask me, all things are done through Christ Jesus. So you're contradicting. So we're not speaking the same language. So we have to understand, when I go to prayer, I can't go praying in my language. Wait a minute, Joel. Can you give me another example? I'm glad you asked. He gave us the Holy Ghost, who gave us a spiritual language that we don't even understand, that the devil don't even understand, that the angels don't understand. The only one that understands the language is you and him. So nobody can give you their opinion in it. So if you change the way you talk, you'll change the way you walk. We have to understand that. So sometimes we're going like, If I'm in a situation when I'm really believing and I'm standing and I'm praying for something and I don't see it manifested, I don't say, God, if it be your will, because guess what? He gave me dominion on earth. So I ask myself, God, am I speaking the same language as you? The reason this ain't coming true is because it's going to hurt me more than it's going to help me. Here's what we do. It might help me on the earthly realm because it makes me feel good, but it's going to hinder me in the spiritual realm. We have to understand, God's not going to give us anything that's going to hurt us in the spiritual realm. How many people pray for a boat? And they got that boat, and on every Sunday morning when it's church time, they're on the boat partying. God gave me a boat. No, he didn't give you the boat. You just bought the boat because that's what you wanted. Now, does God want us to have nice things? Yes. That glorifies him. You see what I'm saying? All things, see, it's not bad to be rich and have money and do this thing if all you do with it is giving him glory. See, I'm a blessed man because you know what? I had nothing until I started giving him glory for every little thing I have. And guess what? We're known as givers. Not because that's what we want to be called. It's just that's what we identify to. Because you know why? We know that God, if I get rid of it, he's going to give me something better. We so want good ground. My wife's famous line, she goes, you'll say, well, I don't want you to do that. Are you good ground? If you ain't good ground, I don't want to do it. But if you're good ground, basically she'll say, shut up and take it. Well, she's not, Hannah. So we have to learn. She has had a dirt moment. Back to the simplicity of dirt, saying, you know, it's not about what I have. It's what I have through me to glorify God. And that's where we have to look at things. It's not for me to gain this big old house, but me to be able to show God's glory through me. And whatever it takes to get... See, remember I told you the way you tell a king's glory is you go to the least in the house to see how they live? So God is not going to want you to be in poverty to show his ministry. Well, that minister, he's got a 18-bedroom house and Cadillac car. Is it bothering you? Are you starving because he's got a house? Now, is he doing right? That's not your judge. It's not my job, your judge to judge. When you sowed in them, if he did God's work, that's between him and God. I'm gonna tell you something, Revelation, write this down. I will not stand on judgment day for you. Yes, I will. I just told a lie. Because every word that comes out of my mouth that I teach, I'll be held accountable for. But I'm not going to be held accountable for your sin. You'll be handled for your own sin. So if I'm going to be accountable for my own sins, guess who I'm going to take care of? Me. I'm going to spend all my time on making myself the best it can be. Because you're not going to stand in judgment day for me. I am. So I got to make sure I'm the best that I can be in the sight of God. Now, if you don't like that, that's when you and God, I still love you. Just don't touch me. No, I'm just kidding. 2 Timothy, see, we get into the New Testament. In a large house there were articles not only of gold and silver, but also wood and clay. Some of the special purposes of for common use. Those who cleanse themselves from the latter will be instruments for special purposes made holy, useful to the master, prepared to do any good work. See, it wasn't just gold and silver that was in there. It was also wood and clay. Clay represents dirt. He pulls out the holy water out of what? A vessel, an earthly vessel that's made out of what? Usually it's clay. In that time, they didn't have china. It was clay, which is what? dirt. So we can't have the holy water. Let's get it back. When I got saved and I got filled with the Holy Ghost, I am dirt filled with the holy water. I'm the vessel that's holding the holy water. And the holy water is no good if I keep it inside of me and I'm not pouring out to help others. What happens when you have water that sits for a while? It draws insects and everything else. It starts to smell, stink, cause bacteria and everything else. That's where a lot of our Christians are. We're standing around and we got it stuck in us. We're saved. We love God, but we're not doing nothing with it. And when you don't do nothing with it, guess what it does? Two things happen. Either it'll dry up or it'll get bacteria and start to fester. We have to believe that. As a man thinketh in his heart, we got to change the way we think about things. We got to think about, it's not about me, it's about him. He made me to be his vessel to pour him out. We have to understand that. Is that making sense, or am I just going off in a rabbit hole? I told you I was going to talk dirty to you. Yeah. We had to more open, I don't know what I meant there. We have to be more open to receiving the lost. I got a little, a lot of things going on this week. I put notes down to remind me what. We got to be more open to the lost, to the dirt, to the world, to the thing. When I make a decision to do something, am I hindering the purpose of God? Or am I doing something that's going to take and make that person come closer to God? In other words, is my life a representative of him? And what did Jesus do? He showed compassion. Who do you eat with? Who do you walk with? Who do you talk with? Who do you get mad at? Called a bunch of vipers. It was the ones who were full of God, but wasn't pouring it out. They had no love. They were stagnated, and they wanted to kill him. That's who ended up killing Jesus. I want our church to have a mixture that the lost feels comfortable in coming in here. I want them to feel so comfortable coming in here, they're acceptable of what the word says. I didn't say I was going to compromise. I wasn't going to say I'm going to take and do things that draw them in here. I'm saying I want them to feel so comfortable they can walk in this door and know that they will be loved whether they change their heart or not. And love conquers all things. Love will change them, not you. We have to understand that. I want the sinners. If you listen to any of you sinners who think, God, that you ain't worth nothing, that you're just people just put you down, you're welcome in this church. You're welcome with wholehearted hands. We'll embrace you with a hug, kiss you on the cheek, but we're going to tell you the truth. We're going to preach what the Word of God says. I'm not going to compromise on the Word, but I'm not going to compromise on loving you either. I will love you no matter what. That's what Jesus did. Because what was his last words? Forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's the way we have to have our mentality. 2 Peter 3:9, and the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but in longsuffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. In other words, God don't want anybody to perish. How many times you flip somebody off? You tell them you want them to perish. I'm just being real. We have to get to the point that I have to be so Christ-like that you can get on that last nerve that you know how to get on, and I still pray that you make it, that you change your heart. That's not easy. It's not easy. But I'm going to tell you what, nothing's easy when you first try. But the more you do it, when you see one person change, it's like, oh. And then you start getting a little momentum. Gets a little momentum. And now it don't bother you that the person rejected you. You did what you were supposed to do, and that's their problem. Because guess what? They can say what they want to. They can despise you, make fun of you, call you a holy roller, call you one of these Jesus lovers and all that stuff. But let them get in trouble and see who the first ones they call. That's what it's about. If you're not on their list to call, maybe you ain't doing Christ-like things. Oh, that's hard. It's the truth, though. They don't see no different in you than they see in anybody else. That's to not be. We're supposed to live a separate life. We're supposed to be like Jesus and love the sinner as much as we love our brothers. We have to understand that. You want to read that one for me?
John 9, 1 through 8. As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Neither this man nor his parents sinned, Jesus said, but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. After saying this, he spit on the ground, made some mud with saliva, and put it in the man's eye. Go, he told him, wash in the pool of Siloam. This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg? Some claimed that he was.
Let me tell you something. This scripture, when I started reading the Bible and New Testament, I'm like, spit. He rubbed spit in the man's eye. In an earthly flesh, though, that's nasty. It's unsanitary for him to spit on him. And it ate at me and ate at me. And this scripture, I mean, I probably studied this scripture more than anything because it didn't make sense on me. I came up to one version back in that day and time. It was said, when there was people who say, I will believe he's the Messiah if he does this. I will believe he's the Messiah if he can take and raise a man from 3 days dead, 4 days dead. He brought Elijah back. They had self-help books with herbs and stuff, just like we do today. So in that day and time, it was said that the spit of the firstborn had healing agents in it. So he took his spit and the dirt and rubbed it on his eyes, and that was what they would do in the day. That was their common time. That was their healing agent for stuff in there. So I think that, well, I'm like, well, God, that makes sense, but really, why would you put that in the Bible? That's not about you. I'm glad you asked. We're going to go deeper. That's what I was telling you. Never let your handicap define who you are. Remember, he was the blind man, and they thought who he was, but wasn't quite sure if it was the same guy or not. All they knew, he was a blind man. We get a lot of times we label people with what they used to be instead of what God called them to be. If you ask my wife, if you read a text, any women, y'all got text for them, what does she text? My beautiful sister. She always has an encouraging word to somebody before she starts texting somewhere. She identifies you as somebody special before she starts her conversation. That's the way we should be Christ-like. We have to say, that child is God's child. Just like when I counseled them, I told them, when you hurt one another, you're hurting God's child. Go hurt a parent's child and see if you don't see them rile up. Go try to hurt Micah. You see, calm Anthony go a little berserk on you a little bit. And quiet Ella turn into a ninja turtle. Because you're going to protect your child. And it's the same thing with our spiritual father. He's not going to allow nobody to hurt you as long as you act as his child. Remember the story religious people told when he shut. See, if you'll go in here, if you'll read the story about, remember they were like, shut up, Barnabas, shut up. The religious people, man, don't bother him. Don't bother him. He basically told them to shut up. But what happened was, the real holy water was mixed with it. Jesus, who was the Spirit, when he spit, that was holy water from an earthly vessel. He was God made flesh. Think about this now. This is what the Bible says. Ain't what Joel says. I'm just teaching you a different way. He took the holy water, which was him, his Spirit, and he spit in the dirt. It came out of an earthly vessel way back into what the law was back in Numbers. He did in the New Testament. And he spit. It was the Holy Spirit. See, the religious people don't do that. Let him go. He's been blind since birth. Don't bother with him. We ain't got time. But the Holy Spirit recognized, if I can take the holy water out of this earthly vessel and pour it into him, I can make him have sight again. If he can do it for them back then, he'll do it for you. If you got dirt in your life, God can turn around and make that dirt something that helps you go on. How many of you know most preachers who are big evangelists had a rocky foundation to start with? They used the dirt in their life to give God thanks for everything he's done in their life. It ain't till Jesus met the cross and the death that we had everlasting life. I told you a while back, if you think you're going to be blessed and not have controversy come in your life or troubles come in your life, you're living in a fairy tale. And your story's going to probably start once upon a time. And it ain't going to end and they lived ever happy ever after, because it's not the truth. See, if you'll note the spit, what does spit have in it? DNA. So when he spit in that mud, he put the DNA of God mixed with the dirt in that man's life, and a man had sight again. So your dirt is an opportunity for God to put his DNA in you and create something out of you that's fantastic and out of this world. You see what I'm saying? I can't live in my dirt and justify my dirt, but if I'll take my dirt and release it to him, allow him to put his DNA in it, then I become Christ-like. It wasn't until I said, God, I surrender all. I'm a dirty vessel. I'm tired. I can't do it in my own power. Here's my dirt. Let your spirit enter in. And when he entered in, he changed me. And I understood he gave me this quirky way I think and talk and walk and dance and sing in this way. And he said, okay, now I can use that dirt with my spirit and I can go win the lost. Joel, you're being arrogant. No, I'm not. That's what the word says. I can't help it if I'm doing what God's will and you think that I'm better. Because I am better. I'm not better than you. I'm better as a man. I'm better as a father. I'm better as a son, a brother, a friend, a boss, whatever. I'm better because I took the DNA of Christ inside of me and I allowed my dirt to fertilize it and express it outwardly to the world. Am I making sense? So we have to understand that. Then he told him to go dip in the pool, which means go surrender. When you're baptized, we're going to have a baptism service because Austin has expressed he wants to be baptized. I'm trying to work out a place where we can do a baptism, and we're going to have a big ceremony. Probably one Sunday morning, it's going to be a baptism ceremony. I don't know if we can do it here, but if we might get another building. I've done it before in troughs, but I want to do a baptism. So if you want to be baptized, let me or Teresa know. You know, somebody wants to be baptized, we want to do that. But baptized representing dying to the old Joel, the old mud dies, and when I come up again, I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. See how all this ties in? It's simple as dirt. It's simple as dirt. They went, now we got scientists saying the way you create a star is from dirt, from dust. What is dust? If dust gets in you, what does it do? It starts to tickle your nose and your eyes start to water and everything. Your sinus starts bonding. It affects you. Dust will affect you. Go into a dusty environment and see if you don't change. See what I'm saying? God says, I want you to be the dustiest thing in my environment. Go change some people. Go make them sneeze. Make their eyes water. Make them look for help and medicine. And that's from God, because that wasn't in my sermon. But you want to be that allergy, that dust particle that goes stir somebody up when they go seek medicine. And there ain't but one medicine, and that's Christ Jesus. We have to understand that. Second Corinthians, but we have the treasure of the earthly vessel, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not us. In other words, not by my strength, it's him. Look at this old vessel. It can't do but so much. It only can lift so much. It only can walk so far. It only can talk so long. It only can stay up so long. But with God, I can do all things. I can even be asleep and do God's will. Oh, that's crazy. It's that simple. It's that simple. I've surrendered him. My dirt Take off your sandals because you have walked on holy ground. The dirt became holy for God to preside. Now that was God there too, because I wasn't in there. But he told Moses, take off your sandals because you're on holy ground, because you're in my presence. And dirt is also under me. I control the dirt. It's that simple. Well, you need to get real and bring your dirt to God and he can heal you. We need to go, basically when you repent, you say, God, forgive me of all the dirt I've done in my life. Forgive me of the trespasses, the things that you're not proud of, the things you didn't call me. Lord, I lay it at the foot of the cross and I surrender it to you. Now you take my dirt and you make me what you want me to be. And that's called salvation. That's called healing. That's like walking with the Lord. We have to understand that. I'm not going to beat you up because you did what you did in your life, but I'm here to tell you what you did in your life could turn around and be an aid in God's life. And it can make you a better person. But here's the main important ingredients to it. It's dirt and a choice. Dirt and a choice. You have to make a choice. This dirt is not going to define me as evil. That this dirt's going to find me as God has, restoration power. I messed up with the dirt and grease. I mean, mixed up batter. I'll tell y'all a secret then. I used to not be able to cook. I've learned how to cook with my wife a little bit, but I wanted some chocolate pudding. So I was mixing up this chocolate pudding. And when I read the ingredients, I didn't have my glasses on. And it said, add coffee. It was cocoa. So I put coffee in it. I was up for 4 days trying to figure out what I did wrong. This is the truth. But I had to take and say, this ain't no good. Throw it away. Go back to the ingredients. Oh, it's chocolate. Mix it up. And I got 2 pound gain there. So what I'm trying to say, that stupid story is in there. You can always start over. There's never a point where you can't start over. That person that you think is the lowest thing in God's green earth can take and say, Lord, forgive me at his last breath. And he's the same in heaven as you are. We can't comprehend that because we want to judge him, and it's not your job to judge. When I preach a funeral that I don't know if they found the Lord or not, I don't preach them into heaven and I don't preach them into hell. I say, I hope and pray that they got it right before they left this world. I'll celebrate, and my hope is that they did, but I can't tell you if they did or didn't. We have to understand, you have a choice. You can take your dirt and wallow in it, look like a mud pie or pig pen, or you can take that dirt and make a beautiful, beautiful vase that can pour out his spirit into the world. It's all about a choice. See, anybody got anything they want to add?
I'd be interested in knowing the baptism also.
Cool.
I was baptized as a child, but I feel this is my choice now. Totally commit, and I want to do that. So.
Cool. We are planning on. We do want to do it. And I thought about doing it in the park. I thought it'd be neat getting the park over here in Indian Trail and getting us one thing. Make sure the weather's good. And but that's something I do want to. Bill, if you would you take the project on? And help do that. I'll get us the location. So today, if you'll get the location, people wants to do it, and let's do that. They don't have to be members here. If you got a loved one who wants to be baptized and they gave their heart to the Lord, bring them. We'll baptize them. So that's something I want to do. We're going to do things outside this wall. God knows that I'm praying right now for a building, and it's going to happen. It's going to manifest. It's going to happen because I want to do more things like this for the community. And before I forget, Charles and Yanni are missionaries. They wished all the mothers happy Mother's Day. They just want to say that they love you and thank God for you for what we do for them out in the ministry things. Has anybody else got anything?
Whoever comes in
prayer,
I just want to pray for Susan Fountain and Austin's mom. She's been sick all weekend. That's why they went home early this morning.
Bill, will you close us out?
Father, thank you, Lord God, that you who created us out of the dirt and you life into us. Father God, you are life, you are truth, you are everything that we need in this life, Lord. So we intercede for Susan, Lord God, that you magnify your name in her, Lord God, you glorify yourself by restoring her to complete health, Father God, in Jesus' name. And Lord, for all those who are making that decision to follow you in the waters of baptism, that you would bless them in that decision, Father God, you'd strengthen them in the resolve to serve you, to love the people that you put into their path day by day. And for each of us, Lord God, as we go out this week, that you would just pour your love into us and through us, Father, as that vessel you've created us to be, Lord, so that people would take notice that we have been with you, Lord, that we are your disciples, your children, your offspring, Father God, and that there is something different of us because of the love of God that flows in us and through us, Father God, that this world would be changed and that our communities would be different and our workplace would be different, our families would be different because of your presence flowing in and through us, Father God. We give you honor, glory, and praise in Jesus' name.
One more thing before we go. Remember the woman who they were going to stone? And they brought him out, and they brought him out there, and she came, brought him to Jesus. What did Jesus do? He knelt down and he rode in the dirt. He returned to where everyone came from. Everyone came from. Everybody wants to know what he wrote. He probably said, you did this. You did this. All y'all came from this right here. And I still love all of you. Now the only one who could have thrown a stone, was qualified to throw it, gave mercy. There's our example. Just hit to me while he was praying. That story come to me with it. Now, that's all, folks.